Hey, Hunter, thanks so much for joining us today.
Yeah, thanks for coming down, checking it out.
Hey, so we first met on the CMT Music Awards like 3 years ago, and we were doing your song Storm Warning. Now, you recorded everything on that track, right?
On that track, and yeah, on the first 12 on the record. Yeah, my label was nice enough to give me the time to make the record and play everything on it, yeah.
So what is your primary instrument?
Oh, it's guitar. Absolutely. That's my home. It's what I write on. It's what I'm most comfortable on. That's what I have the most of, clearly, apparently, as of now, which is pretty stupid to think about, because it's just like, man, a year ago I was like begging for guitars, you know what I mean? Just like, I need one more, you know?
Yeah, on the CMT Awards, we played Storm Warning, and when I was learning it for the show, I was like, man, this is killer playing.
Thank you, dude. Thank you. That was my first time. You know, I make my demos kind of by myself. You know what I mean? It's not because I necessarily like am insistent upon it. I just, for a long time, that was kind of my only option. Like, I didn't really have any other, like, you know, I didn't have the budget to do the studio thing or whatever. You know, I had my little home studio, but I had to sort of I had to build the demos myself because that was like my only option. You know what I mean? So the label was nice enough to sort of, I guess, give me a shot at trying that for the record. We didn't know if that was how we were going to make the entire record, but we said we should try like a couple tracks like that and just see what happens. So we did. We started with Storm Warning, and of course I was working with Dan Huff, and that was incredibly intimidating. But even Huff was just like, man, it's kind of hard for me not to just jump in and play somebody. He's like, I want you to do your thing. I'm just gonna, you know. And one of the things he said to me was, he said, I want to be a mirror for you. You know, he said, I don't want to produce the record. He said, I want to help you produce the record. But he said, what I mean by that is I want to stand on the other side and show you a perspective that you can't necessarily see from where you're at. I want to show you all the different angles so that you can get a better picture of what, you know, what you're doing, what the music you're making. So, yeah.
How cool. It's almost like Prince's first records when he was doing it all himself.
It's quite the... sure. Yeah, that's quite the level to measure up to there. I don't know if I'd go that far, but sure, I'll go with it.
Yeah, very cool. Now, tell me about your first guitar.
My first guitar was actually a gift from Robert Duvall, believe it or not. I met him on the set of a movie. I was like 5 or 6 at the time.
Was it
I was
the
five.
Apostle?
It was the Apostle, yeah. And he came back for my 6th birthday, actually. He flew in, and his gift to me was my first guitar. It was a little tiny little Samick with like a matching amp and stuff. And yeah, and then it was just every other guitar I got after that was a gift of some kind.
Wow.
You know, yeah, for sure.
Tell us about your Martin.
Yeah. Do we have it here? Thank you, Andrew. You've met Andrew, right?
Yeah. Andrew Ladner.
Yes.
This was my first purchase. Every guitar I had up until this, I had a ton of Strats. They were all gifts from like local musicians. In fact, a couple of them still stay on stage with me today. We've teched them out like crazy and done some work to them. But the first thing that I bought was this acoustic. I was actually shopping for acoustics for a tour that I was doing. I was playing by myself, and I was tired of borrowing acoustics from people. And so I went to the store, and I played a ton, and this was the one that just, I don't know, it spoke to me. I've seen, you know, all my favorites play the OM, you know, Clapton,
right,
and Mayer, and everybody,
yeah,
plays the OM. And so I knew the size, I knew the sort of style of it, and I played it, and it just rang in all the right ways, you know, and it was perfect size for me. I was comfortable with it, and I'm a very slow decision maker. So I went that day, and the guy at the store tried to convince me to buy it like on the spot, and I was like, man, I gotta think of this. Is a big purchase for me, like this is a big deal, you know. So I don't think he took me seriously, but I walked in the next day and I bought it, and it's been with me ever since. It actually now, I don't have it on stage. I keep it off stage. Because it went through a good year and a half of some serious weathering.
Yeah.
It went through every sort of climate you can think of. It was outside all the time because we did a bunch of fairs and festivals. And the wood has actually opened up quite quickly on this, surprisingly. And it's actually been it's been injured once before, so I keep it close to me now. It stays on the bus, and it's my go-to recording guitar. That's what I start with everything.
Yeah. What kind of pickup are you using it?
We're doing the Fishman. Is it the
Ellipse?
The Ellipse blend, right?
Yeah,
I think.
That's what's in all of the guitars except for this guy.
Yeah.
Right here. This has a Fishman in it as well, though.
Yeah, I'm using. Yeah, we do the ellipse, the Fishman ellipse blend, because I'm picky, man. When it comes to pickups, like, I don't like the sound of a pickup. Oh, I like, you know, I'm spoiled to the sound of a mic, and I fight with, you know, my poor front of house guy. You know, he's probably sick of me by now, but I love the way this one, in particular, this pickup, this sort of mic blend, has always felt comfortable to me, you know. We found a good happy medium. Front of house guy's happy, everybody in monitor world's happy, and it feels good to play, you know, which is, took me a while to find that, but so when we found it, we literally put it in everything, you know. The five size is the only one that I don't have that system in, but it's kind of my go-to. Yeah.
Great. And how much acoustic are you playing on your shows now?
I'm not doing too much acoustic. In fact, the only song that I was insistent about playing acoustic on was Storm Warning, because it is so sort of acoustic riff heavy. But anything else I play acoustic on was originally something I play electric on, that I like sort of just was like, I you know, like there's a lot of songs that just require a lot of energy, and so I just want to run around the stage. And so, like, one of the songs in particular, we just open tuned a guitar, and I was just like, no, I just want to just go crazy. I just want to sing and dance. You know what I mean? Like, so just drop the technicalities of it, and let's just jam. So, I don't know. There's maybe 6, 7, something like that?
6, 7, something like that.
Yeah, 6 or 7 that I play acoustic on, yeah.
Sure. Yeah, would you mind playing that riff from Storm Warning?
Absolutely, yeah, for sure. Now that I've got the cape on and everything on.
That is awesome.
I almost am better off not thinking about it when I play. When I think about it, I'm just like, do I do that? Do I not do that? I'm better off just like, I've gotten to a point now where it's kind of muscle memory. It's like, it's probably nothing like what it's supposed to sound like, but it's gotten to a point where, like, if I think about it too much, I just like choke.
Right. Hey, no choking there. That was awesome.
Thank you.
Hunter, tell me a little bit about some of your other favorite guitars.
Yeah. Well, you know, when I said that all my guitars were gifts, this one, we call this the Wordsmith because it's got all the lyrics on it. But this originally was a Sunburst American.
It's a 1996 American Deluxe.
Yeah,
96
see?
American Deluxe.
So I know nothing about anything that I have, but but this was a gift from a guitar player that used to play with me, who never played a Strat, and he knew that I liked Strats, and so he gave me this Strat, and it's been through everything. We've changed pickups, we've changed like so many things on this guitar. It's just, I don't even recognize it. Obviously, we've painted over it as well, so not even he recognized it when I played it in front of him the other day, but I don't know. It's just the most like trusty Strat that I've got for studio, for live, for anything, and it's been with me, and it's changed tuners, everything. I mean, it's about the only thing that's original is probably the neck, and I don't even know if that's original. We've changed so much about it, you know. So
that is your current number one.
That is, well, this is just sort of a bit of nostalgia for me. Yeah. You know, this is what I really learned Strat stuff with, you know. This is what I was practicing in my room with, you know. So it's kind of nice that I'm able to keep it and have it on the road, you know. So there's this Mario Martin Strat. This is something, this was the first Strat that I got to be a part of designing. In fact, Mario even put my logo on the back, which
great.
Is pretty sweet.
Yeah.
But I just wanted something with a maple neck and something really loud and really light. And I just love this guitar. It's so much fun to play. And he's actually thinned the neck out significantly, because I love thin necks. Because, I don't know, it's more fun to jump around with.
and who makes this?
This is Mario Martin. He's out of Murfreesboro.
Oh.
He's made this. He's made the Tele that I've got, and this, what he calls the Serpentine, which is sort of my humbucker, you know, Fender scale neck, all that good stuff. Anyway, Andrew can tell you more about it at length, but this is probably my go-to Strat as far as for, like, stage goes, because it's so punchy, maple neck, all that good stuff, so... I love this one.
Great. And you never use the whammy bar?
No, you'll notice that. I've taken that off of almost every guitar I've got because it drives me up the wall.
Right.
I use it on one guitar, and that's the Duesenberg. It's a really nice sound. It's, you know, I don't know. I use it for one song pretty much. Every Strat that I've got, we've locked it down or done something, because I'd never use it. It drives me nuts. I can't stand it. I don't know why.
Yeah. You like to play in tune.
I do like to play in tune. That has something to do with it. Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
you know, this is the Martin that's, this is your signature, right?
So, yeah, so sort of, yeah, this is the one that we got to, that I got to be a part of designing. This is basically a double aught 14th fret. Essentially, it's, you know, it's got the koa. I played one in Seattle that had koa, and I'd never played an acoustic with koa wood before, and I fell in love with it. And I basically kind of worked with them and came up with everything on this catered to playing it on stage. I needed something really loud, really punchy, really bright for like the storm warning riff and whatever not. You know, I don't really want a whole lot of bottom end on this guitar. I wanted it to be really mid and bright, you know. So so this is kind of what they came up with, what they put together, sort of the wood combinations and everything. And they sort of replicated the For the Love of Music handwriting on the pickup of the on the pickguard of the OM, you know, and it's got all the same appointments as the OM that I've got. So it's yeah, I don't know. This was, and then it's got my logo too on it, so that's cool.
So it's almost kind of like a double lot mixed with an OM sort of hybrid.
Totally. Yeah, it's a smaller replica essentially of the sort of things I love about the OM. Yeah, with a little bit, you know, obviously more sort of mid punch to it.
Sure.
Which is great, you know. Just speaks a lot in the mid range. It's great for like stacking too in the studio, you know.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah.
As I was going through it, I was realizing I have no idea what pickups we have. I have no idea what Andrew's done to it. All I know is that I love everything in this track right now, thanks to him. So you should ask him about all those details.
Yeah. All the good stuff. We're here with Andrew Ladner, who is Hunter Hayes Guitar Tech. Andrew, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, good to be here. Thanks for coming out.
Hey, why don't you tell us, as Hunter pointed out, you're the guy that's in responsible for the pickups for everything else.
Yeah.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about, I don't know, strings, picks, pickups, the whole deal. Just why don't we go down the line?
Absolutely. We'll start right here at the beginning. This is a Gibson 339. It's just made an appearance back out with us. It's completely stock. It has the stock Gibson pickups from the custom shop. All of that. He's using this on the song Cry, so it gets one song a night. Fantastic. It just has that kind of 339 tone, but with a smaller body.
Right. So it all stock.
All stock. This guy, he just came out the box. He loved it. So then here's the Mario that he was showing earlier. This has the Lawler Blackface pickups in it. We went through a bunch of pickups earlier in the year, and he was like, these are the ones for this guitar. He loves them. They have a little bit of a scooped mid-range to them, and it's just, you know, this is one of his go-to strats, like he was saying. And it's an older body maple neck, so it's kind of like a 50s type strat.
Sure.
And then out of the Deluxe, we have Lawler pickups in these guys as well, but we did the brown face because he wanted a mid bump, so it's like an early 60s type pickup.
Oh, cool.
Alder body, rosewood neck, everything else is stock, the bridge, it even has the roller nut in it, like a Jeff Beck or something like that. And yeah, this is, like I said, these are his two main strats right here, and they get quite a bit of activity out throughout the night. Next one, this one has Fralins in it. This is his Tele, and Mario Martin made him. Pelona wood is what this is. It's
I'm sorry, Pelona?
Pelona, I believe that's how it's pronounced.
Huh.
What's that?
Polonia.
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 Sounds like a planet. but we have the Lawlers and this guy on a four-way switch, so we throw them in series, parallel. It has a few more tone options
cool.
with it. So you have your two, you know, neck, and then there's a series, and then all of that in this guy, which Mario did at the factory. I didn't install that.
I like your gaff tape mounting.
Hunter is one of the heaviest attack players I've ever worked for, and I would get the guitar back and the string would be like down here, you know, and it's like up under the pickup. So I was like, I've seen this, you know, Steve Vai's guy does that when he uses the trem bar and all that. It's like, and it works.
Yeah.
And I have it on the Serpentine here too. You'll see it on there because that's one song he just digs in to. But and then this is the Let's Be Crazy, as a lot of our guitars have lyrics put on them.
Cool.
Like I said, here we go. Here's the Serp. he was talking about. This is made out of the same wood, Polonia, mm-hmm. as that, and this thing cannot weigh more than 5 pounds. That wood's a really, really light wood. Fralin humbuckers in this as well, with the tape so it doesn't catch on here. But it's pretty much a three-way, kind of Les Paul, wired, just rock guitar.
Sure.
He's even getting, we got this beginning of the summer, so it'd have been June. He's already got some nice buckle rash happening on it and all that, but, you know, he loves that, you know, he loves the necks. It's got the same neck as this guy on it, so. And then move down to the Duesenbergs, which Duesenberg, as a lot of people know, are super high quality, great guitars, and he loves them. This one has the double bender on it.
Oh, really? So he's using, it's a D and a G bender?
It can actually be any string. You can move it around. You can put it on there, and you can put it on any string and bend whichever string you want. It has the doozy pickups in it. I have it right now. He's not using the bender on it because the song that we use it for is just like a rock. So it's like a, you need more of like, this is like a Les Paul Jr. kind of thing where it's just straight up rock type song. So I took it off so he wouldn't hit it and knock it out or something like that, because he's running all over the stage and the last thing he needs to think about is something like that, you know? But it has all, you know, it's a beautiful, awesome guitar.
Yeah, very Gretschy looking.
It does. The neck pickup is
TV Jones kind of.
They do their own pickups, but that's, you can definitely see they were going for that, you know, Gretsch type thing with it. And then our other doozy is a Fullerton, total, you know, kind of 335e semi hollow with the block in the middle, with their version of like a Bigsby type tremolo on it. Their pickups that they put in, like, their star players and all that. I forgot what they're exactly...
Like the Mike Campbell...
Exactly, exactly. And it has just kind of cool chime that he loved. It just, when you hit it, it just, there's a sparkle or... Yeah. It's not a dark tone, but it still has all the fullness to it. So it's a very cool...
They kind of have, Duesenbergs have sort of bigger necks.
They do, and somehow he loves it. Huh. But they're not too, it's not like a 59 Les Paul to where it's like a baseball bat. Right. So, and I think he digs it because he can kind of dig in, and it's got just a different feel to it and gives a little more wood tone. So he digs it. He uses these for a totally different thing than he would use a Strat for. So it's a little more ballady kind of thing. So I don't think he's usually not running all across the stage when he's using this guy. So, but the guys at Duesenberg have been amazing with us. They've taken care of us, and
great, a
great relationship with those guys as well. We'll move on to our Martins, which we are all Martin out here. And love it. They've been nothing but amazing to us. Anything we need, they're on it. He's been an ambassador for a few years now, and they've really taken care of Hunter. This guy right here, he got last year. This is a custom shop mahogany. We call it the mahogany because it's all mahogany.
Yeah.
It has the Ellipse pickup system in it from Fishman, and it's a slot headstock. And this is actually one of his favorite recording guitars. He'll come out and go, hey, doing a demo, can I get the mahogany?
Oh.
So he does lots of his demos and things with this as well.
And is that a triple lot?
Yes.
Yeah, 14 fret.
14, let's see, yep, 14 fret, triple lot. And as you can see, it has, this is the Love Makes Me guitar in the show. And like he said, it's in an open tuning because he wants to run around and just, so we put it in an open tuning. He asked me one night, he's like, I just want to strum the root chord. How can we do that? And I said, well, just do an open tuning. And there you go. He's had it ever since. And it took him about a minute and a half to learn the whole song on a different tuning. It's just like, I hate you. You learn this stuff way too fast. After this guy is the custom. We call this the custom because it has all the custom appointments. It has the logo here at the top, lightning bolt.
And this is going to be a full-on production model that...
Not that I've heard of.
Okay.
That'd be awesome. This would be kind of the, you know, the one to base it off of.
Right.
It also has the Ellipse system in it, and it has the for for the Love of Music, which he put on his original one that he showed you earlier. The Koa Backs and Sides, Spruce Top, and you know, this is just a fantastic. We go everywhere. This is the one we take. If he needs an acoustic, this is his go-to acoustic. This is one of the earlier Martins he got, which is a VS 28. So it has a rosewood back and sides to it.
Yeah.
Slot headstock. The Ellipse systems in this guy as well.
Did you say a BS?
A VS.
VS.
Yeah.
VS.
VS 28. So, and as he said, he's a fan of the small guitar bodies, and they so pretty much everything we have out here are either a 00 or 000.
Yeah.
So they're great. They just have that kind of old world tone to it, and he loves that kind of woody mid range that sure. he gets out of it.
Yeah, punchy. What gauge strings do you use on the acoustics?
We use 12s. Use the Ernie Ball Everlast on all of his acoustics.
Is that like a coated string?
It is. It is. And they had a string shootout before I came on the tech with him, and that's what he loved. They tried a bunch of different ones, and that's the one he stuck with. He was, you know, went through everything. I think he was using Elixirs prior to that, and he found, you know, these had a little bit more open tone to them, at least a little less coating.
Sure.
So he went with those. And
And on the electrics, what's he using?
Ernie Ball 10s. Just your standard super slinky, a regular slinky string. Yeah.
Okay, and so for picks?
Picks, he's using a heavy gauge. We get them through Intune, which is the Let's Be Crazy tour. Bert there is taking care of us. We have sent him some crazy ideas, the band guys and different stuff, and he makes it happen for us. So we have the Double H logo and the tour logo on it. He was using medium, went up to a heavier, just gets a little more bite to it.
So. Andrew, tell me about this guitar.
This is our newest guy that came out on the road with us. This is what they call a Martin V. I guess it's Koa and all of that, like his custom, but we were in Japan a couple weeks ago, or more like a couple months ago. Things go blurry after a while, but he picked up a 1957 Martin V.
In Japan?
Japan. We were in Tokyo. He had a few hours off in between interviews. Like, let's go look at guitars. Awesome. He was like laser to that one, picked it up. He's like, I gotta have it. It's like, cool. It had mahogany back and sides. But I guess Martin got word of it, and we showed up at the Opry, and they came to us with this.
Wow.
So
nice, like, present.
Yeah. I think it was kind of his birthday present. It was right around his birthday. And this has been out with us. This is the one he carries to the hotel room. It's just kind of his personal little travel guitar now, because it's so small and compact. You can take it everywhere. So.
And it sounds big.
It does. It has a very, you know, full, rich tone. And we use it on Everybody's Got Somebody But Me now, where we were using the VS with a capo in the 3, and now we just use this one in open, because it's like having a capo in 3 all the time. So, yeah.
Right, so it's tuned up to G?
Tuned up to G, and then we drop down to F.
Right.
So just like a drop D for that particular song. So,
great.
Cool little guitar.
And you're running through these, the electric rig, it starts with the Shure wireless?
Yep, actually, both my electric and acoustic all go through Shure ULX D4s. Shure has been with us for a long time, and just amazing, a lot like Martin. They you know, take care of us, whatever we need. Great company to deal with. And I have dual transmitters in here, so I have a main and a spare. So if something, especially when you're doing fairs and festivals or a major city or something, somebody will jump on your frequency, and I can just literally hop over to the spare frequency without him knowing, go back and forth. I've had to do it in the
fixing
past
on the fly
on the
during a live show.
During a live, yep.
Great.
He was literally walking on stage and started getting interference when we were in Ottawa, and that's when I set it up like this. I was like, this is the way it has to be. So basically those go out, and then they go out to his pedal board. I have an acoustic board and an electric board here.
Great. Let's take a look at this board.
Absolutely.
So Andrew, this is his acoustic pedal board, right?
Correct. It's really simple. Like I said, we come out of the Shure wireless, and we go into this loop station. It's a Boss RC20. He uses that. He has a little solo section in the middle of this tour, and he does basically builds the song right there. He starts doing a drum thing on the guitars, which the mic allows for that real percussive, and then just kind of builds it up. So that's what the loop station's there. And then I run a loom over to his electric world. You'll see there's a TU2 for muting. That's all. And then it comes back to a radial DI to the house. His acoustic setup's bare bones as we can. That before that, it was the looper wasn't there. It was just straight into a DI to the house. And then he lets audio take it from there in his ears or to the house.
Well, building a loop live is risky business. Has it ever backfired or gone wrong or anything?
Not yet. So
not yet.
My fear from my side is that he's gonna have like a wireless hit or something. We're gonna be in downtown Atlanta and he's gonna be doing the drumming and like, I don't know, Spinal Tap, you know, air traffic control is gonna come through. So I'm sitting there going the whole night, when's it gonna happen? But luckily, like I said, not yet, hasn't happened yet.
Right.
So
okay, let's take a look at the electric pedal board.
Excellent.
Andrew, tell me a little bit about his live pedal board for the electric rig.
Excellent. Like I said, we like to keep things super basic, so it's a really basic setup, which we throw things in and out, but we're really happy with what we have here now. And keeping it simple is best because, like I said, he is running 1,000 miles an hour, and he can't be tap dancing on this rig. So come out of my Shure wireless, and then I come right here into this radial SGI. So basically I come XLR out, balanced out here. This converts it to my quarter inch, and go into the TU2, which he basically just uses for muting on and off. Out of that we go into a Demeter Compulator, which is a kind of a newer pedal we got. We were at Emerald City in Seattle playing with everything that we could, because that's just, it's a playground there.
Yeah,
we love that place.
Yeah, Moon, yeah,
absolutely. Great. And we just were there, and I had another artist I worked for that used this, and I was like, hey man, try it, you'll know if you hate it or you'll know if you love it. And he's like, yeah, I love it. It has a real nice softer compression to it, compared to his Keeley, which is next in line, which is his main pedal. He uses it a lot like a boost, just to kind of bring it up. So this has a little bit softer, and then that's more of his boost. Out of those two, the, like I said, Keeley is the main pedal. We go into this TC Electronics Nova Delay, which we have set up for a couple songs. He likes it because it has the tap tempo on it.
So he's actually tapping out the tempo on it?
Absolutely. He does all of his own changes, all that kind of stuff. He runs the pedal board. We had talked about doing a, you know, like a lot of guys do.
The remote thing.
He's like, I like to kind of change things on the fly. You know, this is just easier. I was like, I think that's right.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's kind of part of the artistic expression, you know, what pedal you want to choose.
Exactly. And, you know, he's always, he's such a gear guy. He loves trying different combinations. So this allows him that freedom to. We threw that in, like I said, with just a different delay texture for him. And then out of that, this guy makes an appearance here and there. He's had it forever. It's a King of Tone Analog Man. Right now, we just kind of have it out of the loop. He's like, he hasn't been using it for this set, particular set, but it comes in and out.
So when he's not using it, he just disconnected, but he's left it there. So.
Well, I have extra cables in your signal path. You know? Right. That's the way we look at it. And then this is an OCD, which is named The Hunter. That was prior to my, I didn't name that, but it's a full tone. I'm not sure what version it is. I would think either a 3 or 4 OCD. That's like his main big distortion, just lead tone kind of thing he uses that for. Added that into the flashback, which is another delay, which he loves because it has the audio tap. So, well, usually it's dark, but he'll be up, he can tap in just by strumming.
Oh, really?
The tempo instead of doing a tap like traditional, like the Nova has. So it's just a different vibe. And we have this set up more like a tape, and that's more like a just not more just like an analog kind of thing. So this has a little more wobble to it.
So on the flashback, it actually determines what the rhythm pattern is just from your playing?
From your audio signal, yeah. So wow. you hold it down and it actually kills the signal to your amp, and it gets a pulse or something from your guitar, and that's what throws your tempo in. So it's brilliant. He loves it because he can just step on it. He doesn't have to think about it or where's the pedal. He just throws it in, whatever he hears, you know, for that particular song. Out of that, we go into this third power. This is basically just an A-B box that switches between our two deluxe heads that we'll see in just a second. There's no A-B-Y. It's just either or. So it just switches, toggles between the two amps we're running at the time. And then there's the TU-2, right? TU-3, which is just his mute for his acoustic line. So, like I said, very simple. And, you know, all the artists I've worked for that were front, you know, it's best to keep it simple because they have 10,000 people out here. They have to entertain. They can't be, you know, tap dancing, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, right. I mean, he's got delay and drive and compression, and that's really pretty much it.
That's it. Yeah. That's, you know, everything else is right here. His tone is in his hands.
Right.
You know, this stuff just adds a little bit to it, you know.
Okay. Killer, let's take a look at your amps.
Absolutely. Have them.
Okay. Andrew, show me the amps you're using.
Excellent. Right here, the amps, we're using two vintage Fender Deluxes for this tour. Hunter has gone through, you know, he's a gear guy. He loves to try and experience and all that. And we're using Third Power Forever, which are fantastic amps. They're built right here in Franklin, Tennessee. Jamie's been nothing but amazing to us and helped Hunter, you know, and all that. And so this is our backup head right here, which is one of his American Dreams, which the preamps of the two amp vintage amps we took out this year. Mm. Hunter came to me, he's like, man, can you bring out vintage amps? He's like, tell me, you know. I was like, yeah, absolutely. I gave him the rundown of, this is what it's like touring with vintage amps. And he's like, I fully accept that. And I'm like, cool, then we can make this work. So, as you can see, they're in head boxes. Originally, they were obviously combos, and
these were originally combo amps that you put into that you broke down, took out the guts, and put them in heads.
Exactly. There's a guy Mather here in town does all Fender Repro kind of head boxes for whatever you need, because he's actually using probably two of the strangest deluxe amps that you can kind of find, a brown face and then a non-reverb black face.
Wow.
Which have a little bit different chassis sizes than your standard 65 deluxe type black face deluxe reverb amp. This one right here is like a 62, I believe, deluxe. Only thing is the filter caps have been changed in it. We found it in Spokane in like February or March on Craigslist.
Wow.
We had a day off. We drove to the guy's house. Hunter played it, fell in love, and it went home with us. Then he had that one right before I came out. He was using it in the studio, the Blackface Deluxe amp, and he loves the non-reverb models. Basically, I think they just give you there's something just a little more to them. The reverb, obviously, adding anything into your circuit is going to take a little bit away, but these two amps are just screaming. So we have like a lead tone amp and rhythm tone is the way we set these up, because he toggles between the two.
Sure.
And that helps with not having a lot of pedals, because he has his amps set the way he wants them to.
So when he goes for a lead, he just hits a switch and pops over to the other.
Throws over to the brown face. Yep. And both of those are running into Ladner 212 cabinets with EVs in them. We have had lots of speaker shootouts since I've been out. And we were laughing because when I first came out, he had the Celestion Golds, which are like a 30-watt speaker. They break up really quick. And then we went to a 50-watt, and now we're at 200-watt speakers. And both those cabinets are 400-watt rated, because wow, they both have 200-watt speakers in them. And then on the back, there's a switch to turn off one of the 12s. So on this guy, we're running just the 112. And then on the Blackface, we're running the both 12s.
And you're putting a guard in front of it to kind of make it not so loud on stage?
Because if you can see on his settings, he's running them pretty much wide open.
Yeah, right. Yeah, one is just pegged at eight on volume and nine on tone. So
right, and then the other one's right about five or six, which you're getting the full, you know, throttle of the amp. So we have to throw our plexi up for the front of house guy and the screaming girls down front, you know. You don't want them going deaf. So, and then the EVs project like nothing else, so they add a lot of throw to them. And then the red cabinets, I think, are awesome. They stand out. And
yeah, that's interesting. It's the only color on stage. Everything else is black and white.
Absolutely. The way these cabinets came down, we were in rehearsals for this tour. He's like, I want to try something. So I went to my house and brought him every cabinet I owned. Brought him up. I lined him up, and we went down the line. And I had two of these blue, in blue. And he's like, I got to have, you know. So he called up, had these two made, and delivered in Mobile on the one of the first dates we did of this. And he's like, I was like, what color? You want them black? So he's like, no, I think red. I think red. I was like, I love that. That is awesome, because everything's black and white, yeah, except for these cabinets. And then had the grills painted up on both of them, so they fit in with the scheme. So
great. So Andrew, I was noticing that the cabinets actually have your last name on them. Is that a coincidence?
No, it's not. Actually, me and my father have been building amps for about 6 years now. And like I said, when we did the cabinet shootout, I had, of course, some of my cabinets laying around, and I threw them in. But, you know, not being biased to myself, I brought in old Fender cabinets I had, Mesa Boogie, and all kinds of stuff, and he just happened to go with those. So he had a plethora. But I'm so honored for him to have these cabinets out, you know, and it's fantastic. Yeah.
That's great. Are you making, and you're making amps as well as cabinets?
Yep, absolutely. And I think he's going to he wants to try out a couple of ours for his recording rig, which are little 16-watt heads, and we do some other things, 100 watts, and all boutique handmade amps, you know.
Great. Just, where are they made?
Bay St. Louis, Mississippi, which is, if you look on a map, it's around the Gulf of Mexico on the coast of Mississippi, so that's where I'm originally from. So
besides guitars, amps, and chords, mm-hmm, what piece of gear could you not live without out here?
My Peterson tuner. As I have told them many times, my house is paid for by Peterson tuners. That's how I make my living, you know. They have been really, really good to me, and I love their stuff, and they're just the best. Like I said, that's what pays my rent. It's using Peterson's.
Great. So, you're using the flip strobe?
Flip strobe. I have a rack strobe. I have a real 450. I have a bunch of them. But out here, doing what we do out here, those are the most reliable, and just, they just work every time. They have the accuracy and everything. So the flips are the way to go.
Do you utilize the sweetener option?
I do not, unless an artist requests it. A lot of guys, especially when you play with bands that have piano in it, they go, something's out of tune, because it tempers the tuning and it adjusts. So I've had previous artists I worked for ask not to, because they wanted that, you know, the 440,
right,
everything, because when they play with the piano open strings, it sounds out of tune to them.
Yeah.
And then when you strum it, it sounds full and, you know, all that. So I haven't used it on gigs, but I have used it with my, you know, my personal, you know, playing, and it works fantastic.
Great. Andrew, thanks so much for joining us today at PremierGuitar.com.
Thank you guys, and hopefully see you guys out here some more, man. It's
right.
Been a blast having you out here. Love nerding out on this gear stuff with you guys. It's fantastic.
I'm here with Devin Malone, who is Hunter Hayes' guitar player. He also plays mandolin as well.
I do, yes.
Hey, Devin, tell me a little bit about your rig out here.
Okay, I can give you the quick walkthrough. I mostly play electric. I play acoustic on a couple of songs. The rig is pretty simple. Just like Hunter, I'm using my rack sitting over there, but it's a Shure ULX 4D, just like he's using. Everything comes out of one pack for me, and comes down to the board here, to a Boss TU-2. And then I use the full tone True Path switcher, which I really like. I've used a lot of different ABs on the market, and that so far is my favorite that I've found.
And that's just switching between electric and acoustic?
Just switching between electric and acoustic. But when you're tying into the house, you have all kinds of weird ground loop and phasing issues. You get that a lot if you're trying to combine systems, sure. At least I've found. So that I've found to be very problem-free. So one side's going to the radial PZDI. I love the sound of the radial stuff. And that new PZDI has, it's really great. It has the impedance switching for the front end. Sometimes you have weird problems with passive and active acoustic systems hitting DIs. A little weird. I don't know if you've run into that, but it's a little weird. You get that weird nasal sound. So that thing's switchable on its input impedance, so you can fix that, which I love.
Yeah.
The electric side is just going out to one of the new Dunlop volume pedals, which I love. They're pretty sturdy.
Yeah.
Into a Diamond compressor, into a TC Electronic Nova delay. I love having the BPM readout. We do everything to a click, so it's gotta be in. I hate when my delays are off, so I love being able to see a BPM readout.
So it gives you a live rundown on what you're...
I don't have it all programmed in. I still just tap it in, but I can just tap and know when I'm right.
Right.
You know, if I know the song's 180, I just tap till I'm real close to 180 or something and go. Right now, since Hunter started using that Analog Man King of Tone, I kind of fell in love with that sound. It's a great sounding pedal, so I'm using the Analog Man Prince of Tone, which is just one side of the pedal, which is really cool. And then I'm using this one of the new Mesa Boogie pedals for my boosted tone, and that's the Tone Burst. I really like that pedal. It's been great. One of the silly little things I love about it compared to some other ones I've tried is the bottom row of knobs, neither is volume or gain, because I often find I go to hit the pedal on and run down to play a solo, and so many times on other pedals I've spun the volume knob up or down when I was hitting the switch. So I especially love that they keep the volume and volume and gain up on the top row. But that's it.
So, Devin, tell me about your amp you're using.
I've used a couple of different things out here. It's always gets a little tricky to find something to fit in. Hunter's such a big guitar player. I mean, his sounds are huge. So I find that the EL84 thing works right. It's sort of that tight, punchy mid thing. So I'm using a Mesa Boogie TA30 right now, which is their 4 EL84. Very versatile amp, but I just have it on like the top boost AC30 setting, knobs straight up and down, real simple, and it works great for me. It's like having a very reliable AC30 head, so
cool.
Works perfect.
And running into this cabinet?
I've used Avatar cabinets for years. I've always used their stuff. That's just their like standard cabinet. I'm actually using the WGS speakers in it right now, which are the Reaper 30s, I think they're called, and I'm really happy with them. They seem fairly flat. They're like the G12 H30s. They're like those kind of, you know. So I'm very happy with it. It's a real simple rig, you know.
Yeah.
Just one wireless split right here and then simple pass there. So
Devin, so what is your main electric guitar you're playing on the tour?
Well, I guess that is a little bit tricky to say. I'm using a couple different brands here that I definitely love. I use this PRS Mira a lot in the set. It has just a pair of, I put a set of the Seymour Duncan Antiquity mini humbuckers in it, and it's just lightweight, easy to play, really just fun and slinky to play for sure. But I'm using a couple of PRSs, Don Grosch Electrojet. This is one of the new Yamaha SGs, my Gretsch, Chet Atkins, and Taylor Acoustic. So that's what I'm using at the moment.
Great. Well, Devin, thanks so much for joining us.
Of course. Absolutely. Thank you.
Hey, what's up, guys? Hunter Hayes here. If you love guitar as much as I do, you should definitely check out everything on premierguitar.com, subscribe to the YouTube, all that good stuff, get all the updates, stay in touch.